On April 17, 1975, the fate of Cambodia shocked the world when the radical communist Khmer Rouge, under their leader Pol Pot, seized power. The Khmer Rouge ruthlessly imposed an extreme plan to reconstruct Cambodia based on the communist model of Mao Zedong's China, creating Year Zero. They deprived everyone of their basic rights and liberties. The Khmer Rouge forced residents from Phnom Penh and other cities to evacuate the city. If they refused, they were killed immediately. And those who were driven out, they were moved into the countryside, where they were forced into hard labor with little food. Innocent citizens were arrested without a serious examination of whether or not they had actually committed a crime. Additionally, children were taken advantage of and their rights were abused. Khmer Rouge was the name King Norodom Sihanouk gave to his communist opponents in the 1960s. Their official name was Communist Party of Kampuchea. Their party leader was Pol Pot. He led this regime from April 1975 until January 1979. The Khmer Rouge, referencing the majority ethnicity of the country and read as the color of communism, was originally created from the struggle against French colonization and was influenced by the Vietnamese. In the years leading up to the Khmer Rouge's regime, the neighboring Vietnam War spilled over into Cambodia. US troops used Cambodia as a regrouping zone, in addition to bombing parts of the country, to destroy suspected Viet Cong targets, setting the foundation for animosity toward the West. A few days after they took power in Cambodia, the Khmer Rouge forced perhaps 2 million people in Phnom Penh and other cities into the countryside to undertake agricultural work. It did not take weeks for the Khmer Rouge to force the people out of their houses. It only took overnight for the population of 7 million Cambodians to become farmers. They were separated and forced to work very hard at the work sites. Children were forced to leave their parents and work in the child unit. Most people, especially new people, were tortured and then killed of accusing or betraying the Angkor. However, thousands of people died during these evacuations. Pol Pot led this revolution based on the Chinese communist agricultural model. To accomplish this, he removed money, normal schooling, religious practices, and traditional Khmer culture. He closed down schools, universities, Catholic churches, Buddhist monasteries, and government buildings, and he turned them into prisons or re-education camps. About 158 buildings were turned into prisons or prison camps, where torture, interrogations, and executions took place. He abolished any type of transportation, postal system, private property, and non-revolutionary entertainment, such as athletic games, dances, or amusements. Under the Khmer Rouge, everyone was deprived of their basic rights. The genocide violated the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It violated 9 articles of the Declaration, such as infringing upon their rights to have food and education. It also violated Article 30, where no one can take away these rights. The Khmer Rouge demanded all the people of Cambodia to obey and respect only them. Although the Khmer Rouge claimed that they were building a nation of equals and tearing down class barriers, they created 2 new classes. They named these the base people and the new people. The base people, or old people, were those who had lived in rural areas controlled by the Khmer Rouge. The Khmer Rouge classified them as full rights people or candidates. Full rights people were those who had no relatives who had worked for the Khmer Republic. They were members of the poor or lower class, such as farmers and laborers. The new people were members of the higher class who were wealthy and had jobs or an education, such as doctors, lawyers, and current or former military and police. New people were considered unreliable and were viewed by Angkor with hatred and suspicion. They were classified as parasites and had no rights. A Khmer Rouge slogan described them as, 17 April people are parasitic plants. They are the losers of the war and prisoners of war. The purpose of this revolution was to turn Cambodia from an undeveloped agricultural country to a modern one. The Khmer Rouge wanted to achieve an average national yield of 3 tons of rice per acre. The population were forced to work as laborers in one huge federation of collective farm. To meet demands on rice production, the Khmer Rouge enforced strict policies where workers labored in the fields for 12 hours a day while adequate rest or food. However, the country had been devastated by war and lacked tools and a healthy workforce. But the leaders ignored the difficulties of implementing this plan and the miseries that came from overwork, untreated diseases, malnutrition, good freedom, and basic rights. To keep you is no benefit, to destroy you is no loss.
I think everybody agrees that in time under the Khmer Khmer Rouge was like a prison without walls.
There weren't any freedoms. People had to eat at a certain time, eat a certain amount of food, and the Khmer Rouge were trying to basically control every part of everyone's life.
In the late 1976 and early 1977, the search for hidden traitors became the Khmer Rouge's main activity. Citizens were made to spy on each other. Encouraged by the slogan, "You must know how to trace one another, report everything to Angkor." Other means of discovering traitors included surveillance, informers' reports, the frequent writing of personal biographies, and confessions. Once enemies were discovered, their names were reported to the district committees and then arrests were made. The Khmer Rouge also arrested people who wore glasses since it showed a sign of intelligence.
So if they suspected someone of being an enemy of the revolution, then they were tortured and sometimes executed. And as the war with Vietnam got worse and they were losing, they started to blame more and more people for being an enemy because the Khmer Rouge felt that there's no reason for them to be losing. The only reason that they could be losing the war against Vietnam is if they were traitors in the society. People who are spies for Vietnam or spies for Russia or spies for the U.S. So they accused people of spying or being an enemy of the revolution in general.
Several citizens were accused for being guilty without a serious examination of whether or not they had actually committed a crime. The Khmer Rouge said, "It is better to arrest 10 people by mistake than to let one guilty person go free." During the Cambodian genocide, children were not allowed to have education and all schools were closed and most teachers were brought to be killed. Therefore, teachers were often poor peasants who could only read and write a little. Although, in some areas, children were given a few hours a day of primary education, but there was never any fully functioning school. The Khmer Rouge said that, "There are no more diplomas. Only diplomas one can visualize. If you wish to get a baccalaureate, you have to get it at Dams or Canals. And that study is not important. What is important is work and revolution." Most of their education was devoted to political instruction.
They taught the children. It was basically brainwashing or indoctrination, where the children were taught that the true parents were not their biological parents, but the leaders of the Khmer Rouge, what they called the Anka, the organization. So Anka was the one they should be most devoted to and committed to, rather than their parents.
They were also taught that Angkor is the parent of all children. If parents beat their children, it means that they look down on Angkor, so Angkor will have no pity on them. The killing fields were sites set up all over the country where the Khmer Rouge took people to be killed once they could no longer work, had confessed to their alleged crimes, or simply just were not seen as being useful anymore. It is estimated that over 1 million people were killed at these sites and were buried in mass graves. Although the Khmer Rouge's actions were despicable, the perpetrators of the regime have an explanation for their actions. The goal of the Khmer Rouge was to eliminate social order and make everyone farmers, which they believed would increase production for the betterment of the entire country. Pol Pot's second-in-command, Nguyen Chia, explained the choice they made to eliminate perceived traitors while they were in power. They believed that they should put the nation before the individual, and that their course of action was necessary for Cambodia to thrive. There were three reasons why the Khmer Rouge fell. First, there was a decrease in population due to the millions of deaths from overwork and malnutrition. Second, there was a purge. Pol Pot ordered the assassination of the cadets in the east zone of Cambodia, and subsequently purged almost all the people living in that area. Third, there were conflicts with Vietnam. On January 7th, 1979, Vietnamese soldiers and soldiers of the United Front for the National Salvation of Kampuchea captured the capital city of Cambodia and soon afterward occupied nearly the entire country. After years of negotiations, all Cambodian parties to the conflict signed a peace agreement in Paris on October 23, 1991, called the Paris Peace Accords, and agreed to organize a national election for a new ruler. The Cambodian genocide was one of the worst human tragedies of the 20th century. The genocide claimed nearly 2 million lives, almost 158,000 Cambodians fled their country and became refugees in America. These factors are one of the major causes of the poverty that plagues Cambodia today. However, Cambodia's new leader has brought light upon darkness by erasing the evils of the Khmer Rouge regime.